it solo once again. It's Russians going against the French, 1812. We got three corps of Russian going against three corps of French. It's a small battle. I think it's 212 points each side. Exactly. We'll see how well that turns out. I do have the feeling that the French are really hard-pressed in this battle. We'll see. But anyway, let's look at the forces and see what we got here. Right here, we've got a corps of Russians, and they're deployed protecting this objective. They're up on this heights area here. They have two brigades of infantry dug in. They're supported by two foot batteries and a brigade of Cossacks on the flank here. Also part of this corps, there is two more infantry brigades. And these are standard infantry for the Russians, your musketeers and such. And they are well behind this ridge, hidden. And opposing them, the other side of the battlefield, this open space here, we've got a corps of infantry made up of five brigades of French infantry, typical troops, and a battery of guns. And next to them, over here, next to my little measuring device, I have another corps of French that are deployed in a central position. There is, I believe, four brigades of infantry, one of which is elite. They have a foot battery as well, supporting them right here in the flank. And they also have some hussar that are part of that corps, but their little light cavalry element. Also next to them, we have way down on the other end, we've got a third corps of French. They are the cavalry corps. There's two cuirassiers, two dragoon, and one light cavalry brigade in that corps. Way over on the flank there, well hidden behind the forest and some rough ground, some plowed fields, basically. Again, there is a Russian-controlled objective right here, as you can see. I don't want to zoom in too much. The Russians are in control of that. French have to take it. Also in the middle here, we've got a village. It can only be occupied by one brigade, and there's a Russian brigade of grenadiers right there occupying that position. It's well ahead of the deployment zone for the Russians, but I'm allowing that, and I'm also allowing the grenadiers to occupy that position, even though it's well forward of the deployment zone. A little special scenario I got going here. So yeah, Russians are in control of that objective. Those are the two Russian objectives that are in their control. Down here, we have the second and third corps of Russians. We've got up here in the lead, we've got the rest of the Grenadier Corps, including these two brigades, and two batteries of guns, one of which is heavy guns, I believe it's this one, and they're also supported by some cavalry, right here, standard Russian cavalry, nothing special. Behind them is the final corps for the Russians, it's their cavalry corps, and they're made up of four brigades of cav, one is Cossack, one is lights, and they have two cuirassier brigades bringing up the rear of this corps. This army is led by Kutuzov himself, and they do have a sub-commander. I can't remember his name, but he's pretty good with artillery, so if you have the rule book, look it up, and maybe you can catch that name for me. So yeah, that's the forces. They're deployed. They're ready for action. Look at the French as I zoom in too quickly. So there they are. And there is one more objective on the table, and the French are in control of that. They are the attacker, and it's located right there, right behind the French cavalry corps. So that's it, folks. That's the layout for the game. I'm going to play this throughout the week. I don't think I've done a bat rep for Blucher. In fact, I know I haven't. Just some live plays, and that's about it. So I'm just sitting down playing this game, throw it on the table and see what happens, make a little scenario, you know, and that's about it. So I'll film it for you guys, and this will be a little bat rep, and you guys can watch later if you want. So stay tuned, folks. This is the battle. We're about to go into turn one. See you soon. Hey, folks, almost ready to jump into this game. A little reminder, this is set in 1812, somewhere in Russia during the French invasion. I will be using some interesting characters and sub-commanders for the various armies, including Kutuzov for the Russians. I like him a lot. I use him quite a bit, and he really adds the longevity of the Russian army. Yeah, so I'm using him. I'm also using, you might notice, as I play, is Lanz for the French. Now, of course, he wouldn't be in the actual invasion in 1812. He would have been taken out in 1809. But regardless, I am going to be using him as a sub-commander in this battle in 1812. Kind of a what-if. So that'll be fun. He's one of my favorite characters in the Napoleonic Wars, so I am going to include him in this engagement. Other than that, it's a 212-point battle. So it's relatively small. There's a lot of open space going on a 6x4 table. It should be interesting. Okay, folks, so let's get into this and see how it turns out. Let's finish turn one and two for the French. I still have to do turn two for the Russians. Basically, the French advanced a little prematurely for my liking. Over here, this corps advanced up to this position. They've held their ground, let loose with some artillery fire on the grenadiers, which are holed up in this village. Didn't manage to cause any casualties. Down here, this corps also advanced. It's got two brigades in reserve, however. But the rest of the corps did advance. It's got three infantry brigades. This one here did take some losses. They're down to Fort Alon. And that was a result of some effective fire from the Russian guns, as you can imagine. The return fire by the French battery back here put down some fire on this brigade that's dug in. The Russians did take a loss there in Alon. But otherwise, all is going according to plan for both sides, really. Over here, what I wanted to do is to get the French cavalry corps in action against the Russian cavalry before I actually committed the French infantry to the attack. But I, for some reason, I disregarded that and launched things a little bit too early. But this corps over here, this unit and this unit, that's cavalry right there. Right there. These two units, in fact, are part of the same corps as over here. So part of their force is actually over here assigned to take that ridge, and they're being supported by some of the cavalry from the French Cavalry Corps, which are plodding along through the fields, unfortunately, moving totally slow, not very effective at the moment, so there's going to be a little delay in getting the French attack moving. They're basically hiding on the other side of this ridge, the French, and so are the Russians. The Russians advanced their two grenadier brigades up behind the ridge, and their hussars supporting them also. So no one can see each other. They're right on the verge of being able to strike, but nobody can see. And of course, the cavalry corps for the Russians is still ready to get off the mark yet. Their artillery. So yes, the Russian turn is next. Let's see what happens, folks. That's the situation so far. Stay tuned. The Russians, part two. What they basically did is they deployed their sub-commander, which is this guy right here. However you pronounce his name, Kutsayov or something like that. I don't know. He's got that I in there. But anyway, used him, deployed him in this battery of guns right here. So he used him to get a plus one when they shoot. So they basically got an extra die when they shot at this unit back here, which is now dropped to Fort Alon. So it was quite effective. Russian artillery is telling a tale here, folks. It's really cutting down on the French numbers as they advance up this little plain here. What else did the Russians do? Not a heck of a lot outside of that. Right here we got kind of a little peekaboo going on as both sides are kind of hovering at that crest line. The Russians did move up two brigades at the crest line, however, so they do have the advantage of holding the crest line. They can shoot from there. That's the situation there. The cavalry has been committed in the part of the Russians. They got the two cuirassier units up here, out of sight from the enemy cavalry, and their Cossacks and light cavalry, or hussar, right here. That's about it. So, nothing else happened so far, folks. Okay, we're going to go into turn three and starting with the French. Let's see what happens. Clarification, every odd turn is the French and every even is the Russian. I keep forgetting that each turn, each player turn, is an actual turn in the game. So this, I just finished turn five, which was the French. And what they did, this corps basically didn't do anything. I ran out of momentum, so they basically didn't move any far forward. So they're going to be subject to some more devastating artillery fire, I'm sure. But they did fire with their battery of guns that's in support, and it was quite effective at hitting this unit a second time and knocked it down to three Alon. So it basically got two hits in that shooting, at long range no less. So kudos to the French artillery there. Up here in the center, I did move forward these two infantry brigades of French. Why, I am not sure, but that's what they did. Meantime, over here on this ridge, the hide-and-seek continues to go on. The French did expose their cavalry up onto the ridge, however, and they're now open to being charged by the Russian cavalry, which is located here with some, I believe they're two cavalry units, light cavalry. and backed up by some Cossacks. And the cuirassiers are still over here in this position. The French cavalry also moved up further into the field. You could just barely see them right there. And that's about it. There was some musketry fire. I forgot to put down the smoke, but there was some musketry fire here. The French brigade right here laid down some fire on this unit of grenadiers, and they took an Elan hit. As you can see by the red dice, now knocked down to 6 Elan. Those grenadiers are nasty. All right, so folks, we're going into turn 6 next, and that will be the Russians.
This turn 6
for the Russians. Over on this side, they really didn't move or do anything much. They still got their 2 brigades in reserve there. But as expected, they did lay down some heavy artillery fire down on the advancing French. If you remember, the French did not manage to advance forward any further in their last turn because of a lack of momentum. So they took some artillery fire, which was ineffective this turn. Even with the artillery commander here attached, I did add an extra dice to this battery's fire, and it was dreadful, so nothing else happened. So that's what the Russians did on this side. Down over here, there was no action in the village. Of course, the grenadiers are still holding. They did take a casualty from the previous turn, and that's about it. But there is stuff going on over here, as to be expected. The Russians played a little trick right here. If you remember, the cavalry were up on this ridge or close to it. Well, they fell back, opting to unmask their artillery back here, which was quite devastating when it opened fire. The cuirassiers, which are over on this side, managed to come through it unscathed. But unfortunately, the dragoons covering the cuirassiers' flank did take 3 Elan hits. So they were smashed. They got 3 Elan left. Not good. So it was a little ploy there by the Russians. It proved to be quite effective. The French are on the ridge, and they do have... they are obstructed from view. It didn't help them very much, at least not the dragoons. There was an exchange of musketry to be expected between the Russian grenadiers and the French infantry over here. The French infantry are knocked down the 5 Elan. This unit of Russian grenadiers is knocked down the 6, and the musketry continues. In addition, the Russian cuirassiers did move up to the crest line over here, actually a little bit beyond the crest line. They're now in a position to be charged, but have high ground advantage against the approaching French cavalry. Maybe I could zoom in just a little bit there. You can see what's coming up that hill through the fields. I believe that's a unit of light cav and some dragoons backed up with cuirassiers. I don't know. I'd have to look. But, yeah, that's what's coming. And that's what the Russian cuirassiers, the Gukov regiment specifically is in there, are going to be facing. So we'll see what happens next turn. Next turn. Next turn is 7, and that'll be the French. Okay, folks, see you in a second.
Folks, turn 7 for the French was complete. This corps over here did activate. They advanced their infantry brigades forward, as you can see. They're getting close up on the slopes now.
The guns are bearing down on them. So as a result, there was no musketry fire here, because you cannot move and shoot. Same go. I think only horse artillery is capable of that, unless a unit has a special rule for that. But it's not the case here. The French also committed their 2 brigades in reserve, which are now right behind the main first wave, which is about to engage the French line of artillery, really. I don't know how that's going to go. We'll see, folks. The artillery over here, French artillery, it was ineffective against this target, I believe. So nothing happened there. Over here, the French didn't really do anything except shift 1 brigade of infantry from this location up to here. So it looks like they're heading in behind their compatriots up at this ridgeline, which have been engaged with the Russian grenadiers and some musketry fire. And as you can see, as expected, the French cavalry that was up on this ridge, the dragoons and cuirassiers, did charge down the slopes at the positions of Russian cavalry, which were back here. If you remember in the previous turn, the Russians withdrew their cavalry to these positions. The French cavalry managed to charge them, and they won both combats. And now both Russian units are in rout. Well, not rout, but they have retreated, and they're facing away from the enemy. So they're kind of running for the hills at this point. And that's about it. There was also some action up on the ridge with the Russian cuirassiers. Let me actually move closer down here so you can see that. Get a better view of what's going on here.
again, as expected, the French charged up the slopes against the cuirassiers, the Russian cuirassiers. The Russians won both little encounters, and the French were forced to withdraw back into the fields. The only thing facing the Russians at this point is a fresh unit, located right there, of French cuirassiers. So we'll see what happens in the next turn. I imagine the Russians will charge down the slopes and engage those French, and possibly beat them. We shall see. But I think the Russians have a strong advantage here. They've got the French cavalry bottled up and kind of clogged up with that rough terrain there. But we shall see, folks. We shall see. Next turn coming up. Okay, the Russians took their turn, which is turn 8. Basically, they didn't do anything here, except they did pull the Cossacks back because they were in the engagement range of these infantry and could not get around the flank, which is what their intention was. So they basically just withdrew straight back to this high ground up here. It's the only thing this corps did for the Russians. They did open up with their guns and musketry in the case of this brigade. I think they put a casualty down here. I think it was from this gun, this battery of guns. This unit did reload, which will give it 5 dice if it is meleeed, close range. We'll see if that's going to pay off or not, because they had a fresh infantry unit, a French, right in front of them. So that's what happened here. The French are still coming on. The reserve back here has not been committed yet. Let's see what happened over in the middle. Toward the middle there, we got the grenadiers still holding their position in the village, and the French are still sporadically attacking the position. Nothing particular going on. French, of course, are trying to flank that position a little bit, as you can see right there. But of course, the cavalry action, always interesting. Basically, the Russians about faced their cavalry that were running back in anticipation of engaging the enemy French cavalry. This battery of guns, which is foot guns, did open up and get some canister fire on these dragoons, which are now fatigued. They're down to 1 elan. So these dragoons are pretty much out of action. They cannot charge the enemy, folks, so they're going to have to be pulled back. He did turn his heavy guns. It's a battery of heavy guns right here, which have only fired once so far. He did kind of angle them, covering this area in case anything comes through. We'll see what he does with them later. The musketry fire continued up here. I think the French took a casualty. The French infantry brigade, that is, took an Elan hit. Still facing off against 2 grenadier brigades. And up here, of course, we've got the cavalry action, the Russian cuirassiers. This unit did charge the fresh unit of cuirassiers, of French, and was beaten. And unfortunately for the Russians, they withdrew all the way back to this position here on the other side of the ridge. So they're out of sight at this point and knocked down to 4 Elan. That still leaves this Russian cuirassier unit in possession of the high ground to receive any attack by the French up slope. So we'll see what happens in the French next turn. So that's the situation, folks. It's getting bloody. It's getting very bloody. We'll see what happens in the upcoming turn. Coming up next. Okay, just finished turn 9 for the French. They did start over here, where the heaviest fighting is with this corps over here. Lannes attached himself to this lead unit, and he is inspiring, which means he's going to add to the melee capability, a close combat ability, of the unit he's with by adding a +1, which equates to 1 additional dice in close combat. It did help. They charged a battery of Russian guns, and they did take them out and break that unit, so that's the first unit, first blood, was for the French. They took out a unit of Russian guns. So the French have broken through over here. They do have Cossacks on their flank at this point, which is not good. We'll see what the Russians do with that. And again, the French continue to march up this hill. This unit right here also charged a battery of guns and unfortunately was forced to retire. Well, not retire, because that's actually a phrase in the rules. They were forced to retreat, basically. So they're now back here, facing the enemy. We'll see what happens. The Russians are going to have to plug this little gap here and see if they can bolster their defenses here. In the meantime, the French continue to advance up the hill. Of course, nothing really happened here in the center. The French are still being cautious. They did want to get their battery of guns closer, but As far as the priorities go, they keep running out of momentum before they can do that. So they didn't fire their artillery this turn, even though it's marked with smoke. Just want to get them a little bit closer. These grenadiers holding out in here. Maybe we can get some closer range fire on them. Meantime, over here on the hill, we do have some action going on. The French cuirassiers over here did countercharge up this slope against these cuirassiers, the Russians right here, and they were beaten. The French were forced back. So now, again, the French are all occupying this area here, getting kind of clustered in there as their forces have been pushed back repeatedly by the Russians. This unit of Russian cuirassiers is behind the ridge. It can't be seen, but it is facing the enemy at this point, so we'll be able to move forward in the next turn. A lot of losses over here. I think the Russians are holding their own quite effectively with that high ground. It's really paying off for them, even when they're charged. Well, that's when the modifier would kick in, actually. You don't want to attack uphill in this game. Down here, it's getting a little confused as to what troops are what, but we do have, I believe, the French were forced back. Yes, they were. This unit here was down to one Elan. It was forced to pull back in hopes of retiring from the battlefield. It's just down to one Elan, so it's pretty much useless, folks. If the Russians manage to wipe him out, they will get victory points for that, or basically put the French closer to their break point. This unit of, I think these are cuirassiers. I think they are. They were forced back. They were forced to back by this unit of Russian cavalry, which was kind of surprising for me. They're currently down to four Elan. These two Russian units of cavalry are down to four and three Elan, so they're still capable of doing some damage to the French. Here we got some Russian Cossacks, which are being flanked right now by these light cavalry of the French. They got to do something about that. So we got the Russians over in this area, and we've got Russian cavalry over in this area. This unit is French, and this unit is French. So you can see what's going to happen. The Russians are going to have to kind of pull back with their Cossacks, maybe, or protect the rear of this cuirassier. They're being threatened by these hussars of the French, basically. This unit will probably retire for the French. It's useless in the battle so far. And also, this unit of infantry, French infantry, did pull back from this musket duel. It's still within range, long-distance range, but it did pull back. It's down to four Elan. So there you go, folks. The Russian artillery is still back here. This unit here did maneuver to get an enfilade shot on whatever comes through here, but it wasn't the case. Russian turn is next. They are within range with these heavy guns of that cavalry unit. That's not too good. We'll see what happens. Next turn is coming up next, friends. Hold on. Finished turn 10. It was a Russian turn. See what happened. If you remember from the previous turn, these Russian Cossacks were in a position to attack these infantry with Lans attached. They did so. They pretty much bounced off the unit, but both units took some Elan loss. Nothing major. Also, the Russians decided to resupply this battery of guns. They have an attached subcommander. They could do that. These units up here exchanged some musketry. Pretty much ineffective. Nothing major going on there. These Russians back here failed to get off the mark. I did want to move them, and they're in reserve at the moment, so they can really haul. But I ran out of momentum, so they didn't do anything. Basically, here in the middle, the Russians have still not done anything. There's really nothing major happening here in the village so far. However, over here on this flank, the Russians did launch a cavalry counterattack with their light cav, their hussars here, and some Cossacks. Did attack this unit of cuirassiers, French, if you remember. It was up here, and it was pretty much flanked and hit on two sides. And unfortunately for the French, they were defeated and are now retreating back from that position. Down to two Elan, in fact. So the Russians had a little tactical advantage here, so kudos to them. Also, these cavalry batteries, these artillery batteries did put down some fire on this French hussar unit and took them down a couple shots of Elan. They're down to four from six. It looks like the French cavalry here is in disarray. There are three units, this one, Dragoon, or Cuirassier, Hussar, and this unit of Dragoons up here have been pretty much taking a lot of casualties. This one is fatigued and is probably going to withdraw from the battle. can't at this point. It's too close to these grenadiers, but it's going to move as far as it can, and I'm sure it'll get off the table. But so far it is surviving with one Elan left. There was some more musketry fire going on here. These guys took a shot at the cavalry, did not destroy them. And over here, of course, on the flank, the French continue to be held in this position, or they just cannot break out. One of the cuirassiers for the Russians did charge downhill into this unit up here. The Russians were defeated and fell back to this position right here. They're still within line of sight of the enemy, so there's no crest line there. But they also have up here a Russian cuirassier in a position to attack or hold this position in case the French charge uphill once again. And that seems to be a major problem for the French. Charging up that hill is causing some grief. And as you know, there's a penalty in close combat when you attack uphill. So it's unfortunate for the French, having all kinds of difficulties on this side of the battlefield. Okay, folks, coming up on the next turn, turn 11, that'll be for the French. Let's see what they can do to get their forces consolidated and launch some effective attacks. We'll see, my friends. Okay, folks, finished turn 11, which is the French. They rolled really terrible for their momentum, so they didn't get much done as far as maneuvering is concerned. They were effective here with their musketry fire. Did put down another Elan hit on this unit, which is behind earthworks. So this unit is down to two. Battery was ineffective with its fire, unfortunately. And that's about it over here. Of course, the French didn't do anything over on this side. They didn't fire again with this battery. I did remember that before I was saying how this unit, the battery, wanted to get closer so it can get into that canister range of the defenders, but that's not going to have any effect or improve the fire because these guys are fortified. So dice are going to be penalized regardless. So I forgot that. So they attempted to put down some more fire. It was ineffective. Over here, of course, there wasn't much going on. The French did manage to get their cavalry up here. They had three brigades of cavalry that did manage to charge, get into action against the Russian cuirassiers. They did win this combat right here. This brigade of hussars, light cavalry, did manage to defeat the cuirassiers, which promptly withdrew. They're down to two Elan, as you can see right there. So now the French do have possession of the high ground of that ridge. Unfortunately, over here, they also made contact, but lost this combat against the Russian cuirassiers and are now pretty much fatigued and out of the action. That unit is back here with one Elan, so they're fatigued. So the French are taking some horrendous losses cavalry-wise over here. The Russians are definitely in the position of advantage here in terms of this flank and the cavalry fights that's going on. The Russians are up next. That will be turn 12. Let's see what they can do and capitalize on some of the mistakes of the French. Folks finished turn 12, which was the Russians, and the Russians had a bad momentum draw as well. So they didn't get much done either. Anyway, up in this area up here, this battery once again resupplied, so it's now at 3. It's going to be rolling 5 dice when it shoots. So it's quite an effective technique, that resupply ability that sub-commander has. There was some musketry fire here, which was ineffective, and that was about it up in this area. Down here, of course, seems to be where most of the action is. Not much here, of course. The Russians are still holding their position. Up in this area, we did have some more action with the cavalry and the Russian artillery, being quite effective this turn. If you remember, the French cavalry did gain possession of this ridge line. They have their hussars up here holding the position. They have a defeated unit of cuirassiers back here, which is probably going to withdraw from the battle at this point. And there's another unit back here. I believe that's either cuirassiers or dragoons. I don't remember which is which here. I'd have to look. But the Russian units, which were here, two cuirassiers, did withdraw from that position and are now located here. These guys facing away from the enemy to get further away. The Cossacks, part of that corps, did kind of maneuver in a way to kind of prevent any assaults from downhill by the French, kind of cover the withdrawal, basically. This is a unit of French hussars, which is still a threat. The Russian light cavalry right here did launch an assault against these French hussars. French hussars had high ground, unfortunately. The Russians were forced back, and they are now fatigued with one Elan left. So yeah, they didn't fare too well in that little exchange. But The Russian artillery, the guns, this battery of foot guns, did put down some very effective fire on a unit of cuirassiers, I believe, the French unit that was up here. It was pretty much almost spent, and it was destroyed. I think it had two Elan left, and the artillery finished it off, and now there it is, folks. It is in complete rout and removed from the battlefield. So that's the first kill for the Russians. So there you go, folks. And by the way, the break points for both armies, the Russians is 7. When they lose 7 units, they're forced to withdraw from the battlefield, and that's pretty high, actually, mainly because they have Kutuzov in command of the army overall, which ups their break point. The French is 5 by comparison, and they just lost their first unit now. So that's the situation, folks. We're going to go into the next turn, which I believe is turn 13, I believe. It's the French, regardless. Hey, folks, okay, finished turn 13, which was a French turn. Got a nice view of the battlefield there. Decent momentum for the French this turn. They started over here on this wing under Lanz, who attached himself to the brigade that he's currently with, which is located right here. And that was in preparation for an assault, which was launched against this entrenched Russian unit, which was down only 2 Elan. All in all, the advantage was slight, and it was in the advantage of the Russians. And as you can see, the French were forced back. Elan survived unscathed. He's back here at this point with that brigade, which is now fatigued. So it's pretty much out of action. But it did whittle these guys down even further. So we got a fresh brigade coming up to support that assault. We'll see if the French can capitalize on that little weakness in the line. Otherwise, the French hold their ground in this position here, advance this brigade as well. This one pulled back out of range of the enemy guns. It's down to 2 Elan, so it's still effective. And that's pretty much what happened up here on the heights. Of course, down here in the center, nothing much happened. I believe the French shot again with that battery of artillery, which was ineffective. It's got one more shot left before it's going to have to retire from the battlefield. One thing to note is there still is an elite unit of French infantry back here that is still in reserve, has yet to be put into the battle. So we'll see what happens in the coming turns. Over here, of course, more action. One thing that happened is the French did retire one of their units. I believe they were dragoons. They were badly mauled. They finally retired. They're out of the battle, off to safety to regroup for the next battle. They also pulled back this unit as well, which is fatigued. It is now out of range. It'll probably retire from the battle in the next French turn as well. There was some more musketry exchanged here. The French unit here is down to 3 Elan. The grenadiers over here for the Russians are down to 4. This one's at full strength. So the Russians are definitely in control of the ridge. Down here, there was more cavalry action. French got a little aggressive here, and they did charge some of their cavalry into the enemy. They did manage to rout from the field a unit of Russian cuirassiers, and that was done by these hussars, I believe. Also, we have the Russians all located in these positions here. These are all Russian units, Cossack right there. And they're facing against these units of French, which are putting themselves in a position for future turns. This, I believe, is a unit of either Dragoons or Cuirassiers. I think they're Cuirassiers. The French only have one left, because one retired. And for the Russians, of course, there's their unit of Cuirassiers. So it's back and forth fighting down here. I think the advantage in numbers goes to the Russians, as you'd expect. But I think the French might have an edge with quality of troops, considering the Elan levels here. So we'll see. That's still up in the air. The artillery for the Russians, ineffective this turn. I believe they fired. Well, if they did, it was probably against these hussars, and that didn't do anything. So, okay, friends, let's go to the next turn and see what happens. The Russians are up next. Turn 14, which was the Russians' turn. Let's see what they did. Momentum wasn't bad. I don't think I got to do everything I wanted to do, though. There was some musketry, of course, right here against this unit, ineffective. But the artillery did lay down a heavy fire on that unit. Now, this unit, by the way, this French unit that was moving up and is fresh, is actually elite. So, yeah, they're moving in their fresh elite troops at this point. And they just took close-range canister fire from this battery. quite devastating. It knocked them down 2 Elan, so they're now at 5 Elan. These units here fended off an assault by the Cossacks, which again bounced off, and this Cossack unit is down to 2 Elan. In addition, they did move up one of the brigades of infantry to this ridge line, so the Russians are moving their reserve at this point. So yeah, that's the situation over here, folks. The French are moving into position to assault. Russians are consolidating in this area. This unit here is all but destroyed. It's going to have to pull off. It's down to 1 Elan left, so it is fatigued. It's pretty much useless. We'll see, folks. Of course, down here in the middle, nothing happened down here for the Russians. Was some action up here. The Russians did come off the ridge with their grenadiers, and this unit right here, in fact, close assaulted this unit of French, and there was a pretty intense fight, but the grenadiers were forced back into their current position. They're now down to 2 Elan, so the French won that little battle. The other brigade of grenadiers is up in this position right now, on the other side of the ridge, so that's what's going on there. Down here, the Russian artillery did fire on this Hussar unit of French, which I expected, and this unit is now fatigued. It's down to 1 left, so that's all useless. This Russian artillery is quite effective. By the way, this unit here, this battery, is heavy artillery. This one's foot. This one's only fired 3 times so far in the battle, so plenty going on there. Over here, the Russian cuirassier pulled back. They're getting ready to retire from the battlefield, this unit of Hussar. Also, it's going to have to retire pretty soon. It's down to 1. Got some cuirassiers up here for the Russians that have about-faced. Facing off against these guys here, these hussars, these French hussars, which are fatigued. So not much threat for the Russians here. But all these units right here, these 3 units, 2 Russian and 1 French, are all fatigued. And so is these cuirassiers as well. So useless stuff. They can't close assault an enemy when you're fatigued. Over here we've got some Cossacks, which are at 3 Elan, facing off against these guys up here on the high ground with Elan 4. So that's about all that's left effectively for the cavalry on both sides. It's basically these Cossacks and this unit here. It looks like cuirassiers, and I think they are. I think all the French dragoons are gone from the battle. So there you go, folks. That's the situation so far. It's the French turn coming up. Hey folks, finished turn 15, which is a French turn, and is the midpoint of the battle. It's the middle of the day. Basically, the only momentum they had enough to do anything with was over here with this corps, which they moved up their front brigades of infantry, the French, kind of closed up the ranks a little bit. They did launch an assault. Lons was attached to this brigade, and they launched headlong into this battery of guns, which they managed to force to retreat. Those guns are now back here. We got 1 more shot left for those artillery, so we'll see what they do. But the French did carry this position. These are elite infantry, by the way. So yeah, that was that. This unit here is in prepared formation. This unit here moved up and is kind of distracted by the Cossacks at the moment, so we'll see what happens. Cossacks are down to 2 Elan. And that's about it. They did pull back this brigade as well. Pretty much fatigued. It's out of action. It's only got 1 Elan left. That was about it. Of course, nothing happened down here. There was no momentum left to carry out any of the actions. There was some musketry, though. There was those little clouds of smoke. There was some musketry here, which was ineffective. And that was about it. Okay, folks, let's go to turn 16, and that'll be for the Russians. Let's
turn 16,
which was the Russians. Now, initially, I wanted to start down here because I seen some things I wanted to get done, basically right in this area. Like pulling these guys back, maybe. I mean, they're at 1. The Russians can afford to take some losses, but this unit is basically, you know, it's fatigued, so it's useless. Except for maybe shooting if it gets lucky. But so what I did, initially what I wanted to do is get some things done, and right before the end of the turn, hopefully I had momentum left, I would use a command to activate. I put Kutuzov on the table and see if he could get a whole bunch of these things over here activated, including the artillery, which you'll notice are gone at the moment. But let's check out some other things that I did first, which probably also was a mistake for the Russians. So anyway, as you can see, it looks kind of bare. So what I did is I started pulling back. I wanted to do this. I pulled back, retired actually, these fatigued units of cavalry. One of them left the table. The other two pulled back far enough away so then the next turn they'd be able to retire. So yeah, I did do that. But unfortunately, I ran out of momentum doing that. I did launch a charge at these cuirassiers, which were at 2 Elan. They charged the unit with only 1 Elan and obviously defeated it. But they're down to 1 now themselves, so that's another unit of fatigued cavalry. But yeah, the Russians ran out of momentum at that point, so I could not do my little command activation up on the heights. Just to give you a look at the situation down here, this cavalry, and this cavalry unit are all Russian, and they are all fatigued with 1 Elan each, so they're basically useless. One battery of guns for the Russians remains. It's heavy. It's fired 3 times so far. They also have a unit with 3 Elan of Cossacks, and that's about it for the cavalry and artillery over here for the Russians. The French only have 1 unit remaining here, and it's that cavalry unit right there. I believe it's Cuirassier, and they're at 4, so they do have a chance to put some revenge down on the Russians. Over here, again, 2 units of Russian grenadiers, brigades. This one's at 2 Elan, so it's pretty weakened now. But this French unit is also at 2 Elan, so they're pretty beat up as well. This unit of grenadiers is at 6 Elan, so it's in great shape. There's a French unit up here moving around the corner to meet those grenadiers. This unit here of dragoons is still awaiting to retire from the battlefield. And of course, there's 2 units of French light cavalry, which have both been broken or removed from the table. They're running for the hills, folks. And that's about it. So yeah, I did make a mistake here. And the reason why I say it was a mistake, focusing on pulling these units back to retire them, was because the French really had nothing to capitalize on my weakened units. They had nothing to hit them with, nothing to attack them with, especially after this unit of cuirassiers destroyed this unit of light cav on the French side. So yeah, that was kind of a mistake to do that. But you know what? You make mistakes like that. I tend to stick with them, especially in solo games. So that's perfectly fine with me. It's still, the French are hard-pressed at this point in the battle. It's still not looking good. So yeah, let's go to the next turn. The next turn will be the French, and that will be turn 17. Let's see what the French can do, folks. Turn 17 is done. That was a French turn. Let's see what they did. They started over here with this corps as usual. This unit remained in place, issued some fire. The smoke there in front of them against these Cossacks. Was totally ineffective at that, to be expected against cavalry. Down here in the middle, of course, there was a little more action. Those French elites right there, if I could focus in on them. They did advance a little bit up to the hill. They got Mons with them. This unit over here moved onto a flank position on this entrenched brigade of Russian infantry. Also, this unit back here advanced forward. It's only got 2 Elan left, but it's still got some fight in it. It did move slightly forward, and this one moved away from the fighting. Hopes of retiring, so not a heck of a lot going on here. Over in the middle, near the village, where the Russians are still holding position. They're at 5 Elan, by the way. They did take another Elan hit from the artillery, which is now gone. The French artillery shot its last shot. In fact, most of the artillery in this battle is spent. But yeah, this unit, French infantry, did move up. It's on the edge of the village in preparation to assault. It's all by itself. But again, there is a unit of elite French troops back here on the road. So they could get into action quite quickly if there's enough momentum to do that. Up here, this unit issued fire against those grenadiers. I think it was pretty ineffective. Otherwise, not much going on in this area. Again, like I said, the artillery is pretty much out of action and spent for both sides. This unit of heavy guns still remains. It only fired 3 times so far. I'll see what they do in the next turn for the Russians. There was a melee, a close combat. Right here, these French cuirassiers did charge downhill into these Cossacks, and they were bested by the Cossacks, believe it or not. And they have now withdrawn back up to the top of the hill. Yeah, so that's the situation here. The fighting has pretty much died down here. So I don't know, we're halfway through the battle. The French are 2 units away from breaking. I don't think I mentioned that yet, but the break point is 5 for the French. They've already accumulated 3. 2 more broken units will force them to withdraw from the battlefield. The Russians, their break point is 7. They can afford to take 7 losses before they withdraw, and they've taken 2 so far, and that's about it. As you can see, the battlefield is kind of cleared out, especially the cavalry. A lot of those are withdrawing from the battlefield, retiring. And when you retire units like that, they don't count as being destroyed for morale purposes. So it's a value to get your troops off the table. So far, there we go, folks. A lot of blunders going on my part, as well as on the tabletop for the French and the Russians. It's going to get pretty heated up pretty soon, I'm sure. The battle is going to be told pretty soon, I'm sure. It's going to be tough. I predicted it would be tough for the French, and yeah, it is. We'll see. Next turn is Russian turn 18, I believe.
Turn 18, and that was a Russian turn. I didn't do any core activations, but they did do some individual activations, and they basically took this unit out of reserve and moved it up behind the ridge line here, so it'll be in support next turn. It's out of sight at the moment. This unit here issued fire on this unit that Lanz is attached to, and unfortunately this infantry unit, which is elite, if you remember, was knocked down to 1 Elan, so it is now fatigued. Also, these Cossacks kind of moved out of range of these French troops over here. That's about it. Let's go to the center and see what happened. Again, not much here at the village. Over here on the ridgeline, this unit of Russian grenadiers did assault the French unit that was here, this brigade here, which is no longer located there. It's just been routed in close assault. And there it goes, folks, right there. So that was a 4th unit wiped out, broken by the Russians. Not good. Down here, the sub-commander for the Russians, who's good at artillery, joined this unit right here, and he managed to resupply the unit. This is a battery of heavy guns, by the way. I'm sure that'll play a role at the very end of the battle. Russians really didn't do much else, and that was it. They didn't have enough momentum to do any activity with their Cossacks here, or any of these units that are completely fatigued, so they haven't left the table. And that's the situation. We're going to go to the French turn next, folks, so stay tuned.
Folks, finished turn 19, which was the French.
Lanz was attached to this one infantry brigade that is no longer here now. Did launch an assault into these entrenched Russians, fought a desperate close combat with them. Both units ended up breaking. Lanz himself was taken off the board. He's not wounded. He's okay. He can come back. But there's the French unit en route. This elite unit of French also withdrew from its previous position. It's now facing away from the enemy. So yeah, this little melee here was pretty desperate, and both units pretty much decimated each other. And there's the Russian unit en route as well. So both sides suffered a loss up here. Otherwise, there was no other action here. The Cossacks did maneuver up to this position here previously, and that's about it. Let's see what happened in the middle. Finally had a little action here. The French did launch an assault, finally, with their infantry brigade that was right on the outskirts of the village. They launched into the village itself, assaulting the grenadiers that were well positioned in there. They fought a pretty tight, close combat. Both sides are now at 4 Elan, these grenadiers and these French troops as well. But the French were repulsed, and they are now withdrawn from the village in this location up here. Fighting against fortified troops in built-up areas is pretty tough, friends. They get a nice bonus in their close combat. I did run out of momentum, and I was not able to get these grenadiers up the road and into action, which is a shame. And I'll tell you why in a second. Over here, there was really no action. The French did move up their infantry a little bit to within skirmish range so they could fire, but they can't do it this turn, of course. And that was about it for them. The cuirassiers for the French did engage the Cossacks, the last of the Russian cavalry that were standing in their way. Defeated them in close combat, but as a result, the cuirassiers themselves were fatigued. So, folks, this entire area of the battlefield is just chock full of fatigued cavalry. There's nothing useful here. So this, pretty much, the cavalry just decimated each other, and that was that. So yeah, the Russians lost another unit of Cossacks, which is right there en route. Also, I don't know if I mentioned this in the previous turn. I guess I did. The sub-commander for the Russians, he resupplied this battery of guns. That was in the Russian turn, though. And that was pretty much it for the turn. And, folks, that also ended the battle because the French have broken. They have decided to leave the field. All is lost. They reached their breakpoint of 5 lost units this turn. That unit right there is what ended it for them. And that was that. However, they did take down 2 additional Russian units, which brought the Russians, let's see, their breakpoint is 7, and right now they are at 5 lost units. So 2 more and they would have broke. Kutuzov, he's a tough one. So that's it, folks. It was a Russian victory. I knew it was going to be tough for the French, and that's that. So I hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to post on one more video and cover the final thoughts on this battle. But for now, folks, there it is. That is a French loss, a Russian.
Hey, folks, that's the battle. It was a blast to play. What can I say? Tactics-wise, I knew it was going to be tough for the French right from the get-go. It had a lot to do with the deployments, and especially in the first turn of the game, I kind of jumped the gun with my troops. I did not want to make the assaults up here on the heights, as well as this village area, which I didn't do. I actually didn't assault this till late in the game. But over here was a real disaster for the French. Ideally, what I wanted the French to do is engage the Russian counterparts, destroy them and defeat them, and basically give me full reign of the tabletop on this side, and perhaps get into a flanking position behind the village. That never happened. Basically, the cavalry just destroyed one another. And a big reason for that was the fact that the Russians were able to bottle up the cavalry. We're trying to get through the fields and the rough terrain. I definitely overestimated the mobility of the cavalry. The French, anyway. So that was a mistake. Perhaps better deployment. I should have probably just moved my cavalry up onto this ridge line and advanced up in this direction. I don't know. The guns were a big concern for me, and yeah, they were effective for the Russians. They did some major damage to the French cavalry. Outside of that, I think my assault here on the heights, again, was premature. I should have held back, and that was my original intention, waiting for the outcome of the cavalry action before I committed an assault there. Because I knew that the Russians had the advantage. They had the height advantage. They also had the guns in place. It was going to be difficult fighting up those heights after taking casualties from their artillery and musketry, which they would, you know, be able to fire on me before I would fire on them. That's the nature of Blucher. Kind of favors the defender. So it was a tough situation. But once I advanced those troops, I just carried on with the assaults, put lawns and attached him with some of the units and used his ability, which is a +1 in close combats, close assaults. So he was useful. He turned out well. I'm surprised he didn't get killed. Who knows? So he worked out pretty well. For the Russians, I think they played fairly well. Their objective was to sit back, be defensive. They had the objectives. There was no major concerns for them, particularly in the village. They weren't really up against anything major coming in their direction. I never use these grenadiers, or elite troops, I should say, for the French. They never got into action. I just never had the momentum. I either forgot to use them, or I just didn't have the momentum to swing them into action. A few turns I contemplated whether or not I wanted to use them to help in the assault on the village, or reinforce the attacks on the heights, which Lanz could have used, for sure. There's no doubt about it. I just did not have enough infantry to take those heights. Or come over here and help the rest of his corps take possession of this ridgeline. And again, the French had an objective to defend, and it's that blue marker right there. So they didn't want the Russians breaking through this area. So it was kind of important. So all in all, I think it was a disaster for the French. I did try late in the game to try and get some momentum back and go on the offensive. We almost did. We took the Russians down 5 units. They can, their breakpoint was 7. But unfortunately, doing that cost me as well, or cost the French, rather. And they broke. They took their 5 losses, and that was their max. So that ended the game for them. The Russian cavalry did outstanding, I think. The cuirassiers held their ground and really slowed up the French assaults. Their counterparts over in this area here, bottling up the French advance. High ground really paid off in this battle for all sides, particularly the Russians. The Cossacks did well, remarkably. Not only over here, but also over here, if you remember, this corps of Russians also had an attached unit of Cossacks to help them in the defense of the heights. And I believe they're right here. They survived the battle, and they basically distracted the French enough to take a full-strength brigade out of the action, really. And there it is. So a little distraction. So that worked for the Russians quite well. So that's the situation. Good game. Learned a lot from it. It's been a while since I played Blucher. It's been a few weeks, actually, since I played. So I was a little rusty, especially regarding tactics, more so than the rules. But I liked it. I liked it a lot. And the first time I used entrenchments, really. I used my little Flames of War markers there. I'll have to build some proper Napoleonic-era entrenchments. Really helped the Russians. So that's it, folks. I enjoyed it. I'm going to play more of Blucher. For a grand tactical game, you cannot beat it. It's fast-moving. And of course, if you like a slower-paced game, detailed game, particularly if you're a solo gamer, you might not be as drawn to Blucher. It is quite fast-moving, and the details it has are pretty much on the grand tactical side. It doesn't deal with formations and things of that nature. What tactics it represents are built into the rules mechanics, and very subtle in the way they come about in the game. Very good game, highly recommended. Okay, folks, I hope you enjoyed this little bat rep. I'll do more in the future. I have more rules to play, including General de Brigade, maybe some more March Attack. I know that was a pretty good game, and definitely Black Powder. We'll see, friends. Till next time, I hope you enjoyed. If you have any comments or questions about Blucher or Napoleonic gaming, let me know. I'll be sure to get back to you and answer them the best I can. I hope you enjoyed, folks, and we'll talk to you again really soon. Take care.